In the Central African Republic, bloodshed continued in recent days. The former French colony in the heart of Africa rarely receives much attention in the West, most recently as a possible hiding place for Joseph Kony's Lord's Resistance Army. But since 2012, it's seen harrowing sectarian religious violence after minority Muslim militias known as the Seleka overthrew the government and were in turn displaced by militias from the Christian majority known as anti-Balaka. Thousands have been killed and more than 500,000 have lost their homes. And peacekeepers from France, the UN, and African nations have been sent in to stop the fighting. But the cycle of killing and vengeance has gone on, including an incident near the capital, Bangui, in which anti-Balaka groups targeted Muslims, killing at least six and burning the homes of hundreds more. New Yorker magazine reporter Jon Lee Anderson was in the Central African Republic recently and joined us to talk about what he saw. Jon Lee Anderson, welcome. First, I want to ask you, why did you think this was an important place to write about and some place that we should know more about? Because it's not much covered.
No, it's not. But 20 years after the genocide in Rwanda, we had a similar situation developing in Central African Republic. And I think people, you know, now once burned on what happened in 1994, realized that a similar dynamic was developing where a sectarian butchery was taking place on a massive scale and the international community needed to step in a way that they hadn't before. I think in this case, in the case of Central African Republic, it was a bit late. It wasn't much, but what there was of an international presence, French and African peacekeeping troops, was just enough from keeping a slaughter and a wide-scale purge, in this case of the Muslim population that happened earlier this year, from becoming a genocide.
Well, so
that was why it was important.
What did you see on the ground there? What is the situation? Is it a viable state? Is it a totally divided country at this point? What did you see?
It's a partitioned state. Where the Muslims had been driven out, I found the anti-Balaka militia. These are the nominally Christian animist militias who drove the Muslims out following the ouster of the rebel Seleka Muslim militia from power. There's a big swatch of the country in which Muslims have been forced to leave. They've either gone into neighboring countries or they've gone to the north, a kind of traditional Muslim homeland, very remote, very undeveloped area. And there, the former armed rebel militia has made strong. You have pockets of Muslims in the capital themselves, armed, and in a few holdout areas around the south and west of the country. And the overseeing all of this is, again, the international community in the form of convoys, not many on the ground, now increasing with the UN new mission of peacekeepers trying to hold things down. But in the month I spent in the country earlier this summer, I found no one on either side speaking in a conciliatory way. There was great hatred on both sides. And I felt that this was a conflict that was going to continue unless we up the ante big time.
I mean, a sad aspect to this that you write about is that for several decades, these communities lived in relative peace. Even though there were underlying tensions, there was not this kind of outright violence.
That's right. That's right. What it took was for the Muslim minority to come to power in the form of a militia that misbehaved and thus brought out all of the underlying hatreds and enmities that are there in a lot of these sectarian states. But democracy was never built in Central African Republic since it became independent in 1960. And the way to change power was through the gun. The military became more and more involved in politics, and the Muslims, in turn, became part of that picture. And so you now have a situation where you have armed people in both camps. It was not originally sectarian. It now has become sectarian. And you have a country that's in a de facto state of partition, much as we're seeing develop across North Africa, it has to be said. And I think this is a challenge to the international community in the form of the UN, mm-hmm. which is our construct for these emergencies, to figure out something new, because we now have a series of states that are in a permanent band-aid situation without anyone who's involved, as well-intentioned as they are, really hopeful that they're going to make a difference this time.
Well, that's what I was wondering. To what extent is what's happening in the Central African Republic tied to more global international terrorism or other issues? Or is it at the moment at a kind of tipping point, a potential tipping point, where it is ripe for that? How do you describe it now?
I would say the latter, Jeffrey. Yes, definitely. I even spoke to a founder of the Seleka, that is to say the ousted Muslim group, who said that although there is not a jihadist element in the community so far, that the younger men who are very frustrated are becoming more and more extremist. And he worries that if the situation continues as it is, that you will have a part of the Muslim community ripe for jihadism. It is in a very bad neighborhood, as we know. And I think the most important thing about CAR, as people tend to abbreviate it, Central African Republic, is that, you know, it's a black hole in a world in which we cannot not afford to have any black holes anymore. There are people seeking opportunities in such places. And where you do have this kind of, so, not to overstate it too much, but a Christian-Muslim standoff, apparently, there are people on both sides who would exploit that opportunity.
All right. Jon Lee Anderson of The New Yorker on the Central African Republic. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.